Hi. So today we're going to be going over a MacBook Air with no backlight. It's a little bit sad in my office today because my amp finally died. So I got these TLCS 3.6 speakers in my office here, and I power them with this Parasound HCA 1000A amplifier that I fixed back when I was 16 years old, and it's dead, and this makes me sick because I have no music. I like having music while I work, and every time I try to work on this, somebody else walks in with some, you know, I want to pay you to fix a motherboard. Man, like, I don't want to fix your motherboard. I want to fix my app. So it's sad because I know, like, realistically speaking, I'm never going to have time to get to that. I had a TV in my apartment that had lines on it for about 3 years, and I just fucking gave up and admitted I'm never going to get around to opening it and replacing the one component that I know is bad on that TV. I just knew it was never going to happen. So I just bought another one. Same thing, everything that actually belongs to me, I make no time for. I would have thought that this many years in that I would have been able to find at least one person that actually consistently shows up to work that can do this. Because like I found people that have a little bit of a brain that don't, that, you know, they say that they'll show up to work and then one day they just stop showing up and it's like, okay, goodbye. I've had people that say they show up to work regularly, that I paid a decent salary, that said they knew what they were doing, that, oh my Jesus, I would, that BlackBerry would fix motherboards better than. So it's one of those things where, there's a phone number on the bottom of this computer. I have to cover that. Creep. One of these days, I will find somebody who can actually do this stuff so that I can do shit like fix my own personal amplifier. Because it's not even about fixing that, because, I mean, I make enough money at this point that if I just want to buy another amplifier, I'll just buy another amplifier. It's not about the money, you know? It's the first amp that I ever fixed. I bought that thing when I was broke. There's some sentimental value attached there. I'm not going to throw that thing away. Even though it doesn't have its cover or casing anymore since it's been through so many places where I had the cover off of it because I've fixed it for screwing up so many times and poor little amp. And it's missing its feet. The feet are broken off of it. But I don't care. You know, the feet's missing. The cover's missing. Has wire going over the relay because 16-year-old me couldn't find a fucking relay. But it works, and it sits under my desk every day and powers my speakers. And that's what counts, right? That's what counts. Like that and these speakers. I mean, the guy who made these speakers actually died, so I can't get driver replacements for them. I'm not kidding. When one of the tweeters broke, I used to send them there. And now I can't anymore, so what I did is I actually took the coil and I started unwinding it and I find little place where it's broken and I wound up reattaching it. Obviously, it's not going to sound the same as it did before, but it sounds better than 99% of the shit that you hear on the market today. Oh, when I see those Bluetooth speakers, man, I just want to fucking puke in my mouth. Like, the death of hi-fi, or the not even hi-fi, like expensive stuff. When I say hi-fi, I mean somewhat decent, usable audio. It just died a long, long time ago. That's one of the things. I'm a real cheapskate, but I enjoy listening to sound on good stuff. And you don't have to spend like a ridiculous amount of money on good stuff. You know? I remember buying some Axiom speakers for like $300. Screwed up Marantz 1060 was $50. I fixed the Marantz 1060. That thing was a good sound. Oh, the loudness button on that. Love the loudness button. But the stuff that actually matters is pretty cheap. Like you got all these jackasses that spend $300,000 on speakers and they spend nothing on room treatment. Like these panels, I mean, the Owens Corning 703 fiberglass. I mean, this costs virtually nothing. And, you know, this fabric I actually got for free from John Grosspart of Planet to Planet Studios. He had a bunch left over in the room I was renting from him. So, and I still had some leftover wood, so built these. See? If I yell into it, ah! See how there's no reflection there? There's no annoying reflection? Those annoying reflections are what make regular rooms sound like shit. So you got all these jackasses that spend, you know, $2,000 on their CD player, $5,000 on their cables, $50,000 on their speakers, and no money on their room. It's just so, so silly. Like, it's not silly to not have room treatment, but it's really silly, ridiculously silly, to spend so much fucking money on this shit. I mean, I would bet, I would take a safe bet that 75% of the people that read Stereophile magazine, that buy based on what they read in Stereophile magazine, do not do anything for the sound of their room. Like, they think, I put a carpet down, I'm done. So silly. So when people get on that holier-than-thou audiophile bullshit, I just laugh. But I like good-sounding audio. You don't gotta spend a ridiculous amount of money, but... I hate Bluetooth speakers. Hate. Yeah, my last video that I did was on, you know, why I don't have any sponsors, so, yeah. That's an entire group of people there that I'm already pissing off. Because I, you know, that's a great way to know when to unsubscribe. The day that you see me saying we're sponsored by this company that makes this little shitty Bluetooth speaker, just unsubscribe. I mean every single one of you. Unsubscribe, hack my account, delete every video I've ever made, please. Like, for my own good. Because at that point, you know, at that point it'll be just really sad. So let's get down to business here. So this is a machine that has no backlight. And... ew. Ew. Oh, you got some nice hair. Some nice ball juice around here, in addition to the hair. Pretty stuff. All right, let's turn on the air filter. And the fume extractor. Get to work on this gross, nasty pile of shit. Ew. Oh, this is just reeks of ew. Before we do anything or toss this into an ultrasonic cleaner, I'm going to want to preserve as much as I can. Remember, if you just senselessly toss this into an ultrasonic, you may be destroying solder joints that were otherwise recoverable. And then you have to go look for them. And that's no fun. This is kind of nasty. Once you can tell, you see that the pad is worn away, it's like you don't see this metallic stuff anymore. I just dump it. It may actually be usable, but I don't care. Go away, go away. I would much rather be fixing my parasound right now than this piece of shit. It's not a quick fix either. I mean, let's say it's a bad bank of transistors. You got to get every screw out of that thing. Then you have to remove the board from the heatsink, but the heatsink is tied to the transistors. The transistors are soldered onto the board. It's like, I remember fixing that the first time. And that was surprising. It's so long ago, but, you know, that was a project. Like, that was an honest project that took time. Okay, so we're missing the pads that we need for backlight there. Usually I add leaded solder, and a lot of people ask why I add leaded solder before I do, before I wick. I figured I would show you what it's like to try and do this shit without adding leaded solder first, just to give you an idea. So you know how it usually just sucks it up and it's like magic, and see how annoying it is now? So watch, I'm gonna add leaded solder to the pads, and you'll be able to see how easy it is to wick compared to the lead-free stuff. And I'm using a high temperature. I'm using 840 Celsius, so. This is not a low temperature by any means. I'm often doing this stuff at a high temp. Let's see, is there a pad under there that I can bring back, or? No, there's shit. Anything here? Shit there as well. So it's going to make a nice big old mess of leaded. And we're going to wick that all up. Somebody asked if I would consider live streaming this, and I didn't mean to be an asshole when I laughed at them. It's just, you realize I use Time Warner Business Cable, right? Like, I used to have 5 megabit per second up. I upgraded for a few months, and then when I didn't need it anymore, I wanted to go back to my old tier of 30 and 5. Well, now I'm paying the same 179 that I was back then, but I'm paying that for 20 and 3. Like, what? I mean, I don't even think you can view low-resolution porn at 3 megabit per second. Much less split-screen, 1080p, 60 frame per second. Board repair. Not to mention that I also use that for, you know, the voiceover IP for the store, for online backups, for all sorts of other stuff. So I mean, yeah, there is no way in hell I will be able to do live streams until Fios comes here. Now the problem with Fios is Verizon had some kind of agreement with the city where either all of it or most of it will be wired by 2016. And as with most large companies like Verizon, they were full of fucking shit. So they got this agreement. I know a lot of people are going to say, well, nobody else was trying to do what Verizon was, so you have to cut them some slack. What you have to understand is that when a company like Verizon strikes an agreement with the city pretty much says nobody else but you is going to be allowed to do this. So they get a monopoly. So now they've got that monopoly, and they don't do anything with it. Sucks. Because now what Verizon is essentially doing is giving Time Warner a monopoly. So like literally two blocks from here, if I wanted, I could get Fios. But in this specific location, I cannot. And I'm not in the middle of nowhere. This is, it's 12th Street and 1st Avenue in Manhattan. This is a business-zoned store. It's not even like a bunker or something. It's a fucking store. It's a ground-level store. That's horseshit. Nobody on this block can get Fios, actually. Not just me. Literally, nobody can. Which is complete bullshit. I can get DSL from Verizon. And you know what Time Warner Cable does? Do you know what they do when they realize that all you can do is get that? This is the other thing about Time Warner. This is why I wouldn't piss on the CEO of Time Warner if he was on fire. What they do is they have different pricing for different areas. So since they know in this area that I can only get DSL, their pricing is based on competing with DSL. Now in areas with Fios, their pricing is based on competing with Fios. So, you know, just miles away, the pricing is going to be totally different because they fucking understand that I'm stuck with DSL. So what they do is they pretty much match Verizon's pricing with copper wiring, you know, the shitty copper crap with this, which is bullshit. I mean, I get why they do it. I get why they do it. I get the business reasons behind why they do it. I am a capitalist. But at the same time, I wouldn't piss on them if they were on fire. I mean, I would have no aversion to ripping off Time Warner. Like, none at all. I was a loyal customer for Time Warner for 3 fucking years. I changed my plan for a few months for something so that I can pay them more money. So I was paying like $400 or $500 a month for this 200 down, 15 up plan, which is bullshit. 15 megabit per second up should not cost $300 to $500 a month. And after doing that, when I switched back to the original one that I had, so I wanted to keep paying them just what I was paying before, they say, no, fuck you. Now you get a shittier plan, but for the same amount of money. I'm not for robbery, I'm not for theft, but man, Time Warner, just, no. Like, if their building got raided during a flood or something, I wouldn't give two shits of a fuck. I have no sympathy for Time Warner. The other funny thing here is going to be, I bet at the end of this that the backlight fuse is actually good. The fuse on these machines is actually the LCD connector itself. The LCD connector has less ability to pass current than the fuse does. So in so many of these situations, the fuse is fine. Let's see if I'm right or full of it. We're going to take the multimeter, put it down, and do this. The fuse is fine. 0 voltage drop. You still look at this. The pad is burned. It's gone. All of this damage and shit occurred, and the fuse is fine. That's beautiful. That is beautiful. Now we grab a connector. I really want to fix that power sound. I kind of hate myself for not having the time to fix my own power sound. I also hate myself for making a bump on the connector over there, but what are you going to do? Life doesn't always end up the way you want. You don't always get to not make a scratch on the connector. Okay. So, remember, it's important that it be flat on the board, so we're going to push, and bam, same for the other side. Okay, it's soldered on there. Not really flat, though. So I push on the metal piece, not the plastic piece. And it's there. And it's lopsided like most of the things that I do, but what are you going to do? This is why I'll never be IPC certified. This is why... Okay. So, let's go down the line. That is really not aligned. I can't say it's false advertising, though. I mean, I do have years of videos where nothing I do is ever aligned properly. So... people know what they're getting by now. It'll still work. I know I could take this off and try to align it again, but it's probably going to be even worse alignment than it is right now. But some days you just have to know when to give up. Okay, we go up here. Ugh. Got a bit of flux on my finger from that syringe. By finger, I mean my glove. But I'm going to clean off my glove before that glove touches everything I own and gets flux all over it. Okay, now back to the connector. Okay, now technically that is kind of sort of good enough for backlight, but hell if I'm going to trust that. So I'm going to run a wire from here to there, just because, again, I don't want to trust that. It looks like shit. One of the pads is missing. The other pad there is barely present. And again, I could scratch away, and I could just use the scratched away portion, but I want this to actually last. As much as I joke about not caring that things are misaligned, I don't care about the things that don't matter, but you have to care about the things that do matter. Not caring about the things that do matter just kind of makes you a piece of shit. So, let's put this down there. Bam. You don't want to get any solder inside the connector, because then you lose the game. Let's try to get the hot part of the iron in there. Okay. Hello. Sure. What can we do for you? This should be fun. Hi.
Hi.
Yes, I am. How would I find the make and model of my printer? Yeah, so where would I find the model of the printer? When telemarketers call you, the worst thing that you could do is hang up on them. Because when you hang up on the telemarketer, you send a lesson that there's no negative consequence for them bothering you. The best thing to do when you get a cold call from a telemarketer is to waste as much of their time as humanly possible. It demoralizes and discourages them, and hopefully gets more and more people to leave that disgusting profession. Anyway. Yeah, so how would I find the model of my printer? So the front or the back? Okay, it says HP Desk Jet. Desk Jet. Yes. Yes, like jet.
And the model
number? 720C.
720C.
C as in cat. I got that printer for Christmas in December of 1997.
Hello?
Hello?
Yes, I didn't catch your name.
Oh, my name is Lewis.
Okay.
Louis? Hi.
Hi, thanks for holding me, Chris. I'm one of the place managers here. How are you?
I'm good.
Okay, it's very nice to hear. I'm just going to provide you our pricing for your HP DeskJet 720C.
Yes, yeah, that's the model of my printer, the HP 720C. So you sell ink for this printer?
Yes, we do.
Ah. That's amazing that you have ink for this printer. I don't think mine is a tricolor. It only has one ink cartridge for color.
So, instead of tricolor, it is independent color, fine magenta and yellow?
No, it's one ink cartridge for color and one ink cartridge for black and white. No, right now we're paying $9 from our current vendor.
$9?
Yes,
how many pieces do you normally order? One? How many pieces?
We usually order 5 cartridges at a time once a year, and that lasts us. So, $50 a year is what we're spending right now on these cartridges. Uh-huh.
How much
for
the cartridge?
The cartridge will usually last us for 1 year, actually, the printer cartridge. Yeah, it's an HP 720C desk jet printer. So can you beat $50
a year?
$50 a year? Yeah, that's what we're currently paying.
If it's below our cost, I'll try and then I'll get back to you if I can see that, okay?
Okay, I have another printer. Maybe you'd be able to help me with a different one.
Yes.
It's a Brother MFC. Where would I find the model number?
In the printer or inside. Can you check? Can you open the cartridge? Inside, you'll also see the cartridge number.
Okay, I see it. It's 1217 is the number that I see. 1217. Does that sound right to you?
Hold on a sec for me. Let me check if we have 1217 here. Is that HP or Brother?
That's for the brother.
Brother. No, I can't find 1217. What's the cartridge number? Can you open the
Yeah, give me one sec. Okay, let me just find the person who opens the printers and changes the cartridges. Give me 1 minute to find that.
Okay.
Okay, so it looks like the cartridge number is do you have a pen? Are you ready? Okay, so the cartridge number is 40816.
4086.
Yes, is there any place else I should check for the number? The printer is a Brother 1217. Yeah, HP doesn't make a 1217, so that's kind of interesting.
There is HP 1217, but I can't see. All I have here.
All right, so what you're going to want to do here is see if there's a short to ground when you plug the cable back in. So right now, what we're going to do is do this, and on backlight output, I'm going to take the red probe. So I'm going to take the red probe and put that on ground, and the black probe is going to go on. You're the donor board. So we're going to take the red probe and put that on ground, and the black probe is going to go on backlight. Are you following along? And that number indicates that feedback is probably missing. Are you following along, ma'am? You've got to waste the time of telemarketers. If you don't waste their time, they will keep their job. And then after that, I am going to try the same thing, but with the LCD connector plugged into the printer. They speak shit English, so if I say printer once every 5 seconds, they'll actually think I'm having a conversation.
What are you doing? Are you opening the printer?
I'm replacing the LVDS connector on my printer. I'm hoping after that it'll show me on the screen what model it is. See, yes, please. They're actually following along. And this is the thing with telemarketers. Like, they could be making other sales right now. They could be talking to somebody who's actually stupid enough to buy whatever the crap it is that they're selling. Because keep in mind, if what they were selling was actually good, they wouldn't have to cold call people. That's the thing with these type of services. Like, you don't see me fucking calling up e-waste companies and repair stores and going, "Hi, we fix motherboards. Do you want us to fix your motherboard?" No. If you're good at what you do and you have a good product or a good service at a good cost and people respect you, they will come to you. You won't have to deal with any of this shit. But if what you're selling sucks, then you will have to do this cold calling bullshit. And bother people at work. No, fuck that. You're not wasting my time. I'm wasting your time. That's one of the things in life. Whoops, I didn't check for a short with it plugged in. Anyway, so I plugged the screen cable in. And there's no short with the screen cable plugged in. The number's still a little low, but I'm a little curious as to what I'm getting here. So the whole, remember, I always try to turn it around on somebody else. It's not that I'm expensive, it's that they're cheap. It's not that you're going to waste my time and I'm going to hang up the phone going, "Grr, telemarketer." That's not how it's going to go. I'm going to waste your time while continuing what I'm doing. That's the way this works. Okay, do we get smoke, fire, or backlight? No light. All right, let's take a look and see what number we have on voltage for backlight output.
Hello, Louise?
Oh, yes, I'm still, it looks like the, you need the number, right?
All right.
So the number that we get right now is 8 volts. Now that means that there's no boosting going on. So let's just go through the circuit and see if we can figure out why there's no boosting going on. Now there are a couple of things that can cause this. All right, so I'm going to go over to U7701. Now if I had 0 volts, I would assume that there's a break in the circuit or that this transistor is not opening. But this transistor is opening. They're still on the line, by the way. And this means that, you know, I don't have a break in the circuit. Now, no boosting can be a number of things. It could be that the backlight enable signal is missing.
Hi, Louise, what are you talking about? I'm just going to verify the model number of the printer.
Oh, the model number of the printer is MFC1217 from Brother. MFC1217, like multifunction copier. So, backlight enable over here has to be 3 volts. If it's not 3 volts, it will not boost. If PWM is too low, it will not boost.
Terms. I'm not a technical person. I'm just going to verify the model number. number. You said Brother MFC-12?
Yes, it's an MFC-1217 printer.
Let me check. I'll check Google if I can find that. Okay. All I have here is HP LaserJet Pro 1217. It's not Brother. You sure it's Brother or HP?
It's definitely a Brother printer. I can say that. I know that much for sure. Now I'm going to have to flip the board over so that I can measure the bottom of it.
Because you said you're the one ordering the toner cartridges, right?
No. My receptionist orders the toner cartridges.
Yeah, because even in Google, if I track Brother MC-1217, I can't find that. All I have is HP LaserJet.
Are you sure Google's right? Maybe Google's wrong.
Right.
It's possible that Google's wrong.
Is it 1270 or 1217?
1217.
1217.
Yeah, 1217.
Okay. Can I speak with your secretary, please, if possible? Because I would ask her what's the cartridge number.
Well, yeah, if you think that will make it easier, we can go ahead and do that. Right. Just give me 1 second to find her. Okay, so I'm going to measure backlight enable voltage.
So
backlight enable is 2.8 volts.
You're the one who decides the
backlight PWM is the voltage it's supposed to be, so it should be boosting, which means either feedback is not present or the LED driver is bad. So let's take a look at the feedback section and see if that is broken here. So if the feedback section is broken, still on. All right, so we're going to go over here. Okay. Now let's look at where feedback is. First off, my air filter is stuck on here. How much?
349. For a year. It was expired May
1st. Expired?
Yes.
You know, the only time you ever come here is to ask for my credit card number. Boo. Okay, so I'm going to check where the feedback line is. This is a very common thing to go bad. So check this out. This is important.
Hey, Louis,
you're going to notice this.
Hi, would you mind if I call you back about this?
I'm not going to... Yeah, this phone number is not going to be available later on, so I'm not sure if I'll be able to take your call at a later time. All right, so see this over here? Check it. I almost missed this over here. So this is going to be where backlight output goes back into the chip so that it can read, you know, it can actually see the voltage that it's outputting. A lot of different circuits have feedback. And I go over what feedback is and the importance of it in a bunch of other videos. And it's this point right over here that's covered in corroded shit. See this? See this? It's going away. So, all right, we're going to run a wire. You can barely see that, can you? See this? See that little nub? See how that's broken away from the backlight section? We just got to run a little bit of a wire and we'll be good. Now, one of the things that you can do if you're not comfortable with running a wire there is you can actually take a solder ball and drop it in there, and then you can make a pad. Because what you're going to find is that the wire itself, you're going to find that the wire is actually going to wick away the solder that you put there. So what you can do is you can take an individual solder ball, like the type that you would use to reball an LVDS mux or an SMC or any type of small chip on an iPhone, and you can shove it in there. So let's do that now. So I'm going to take my reballing jig, because my reballing jig is always filled with balls. And let's just drop a ball in there. Still on the phone, by the way. This is cruel at this point. I'll just hang up. But yeah, how much of that telemarketer's time do you think I wasted? Good amount. How many more sales could they have made? See, that's the real important thing when you get a telemarketer. You got to figure out how to waste their time. There has to be a legitimate negative repercussion that has real, you know, that actually hurts them. Or else they're just going to keep fucking doing it. So I just took a bunch of solder junk. I put some flux in there. Now I'm going to try to make something that I can actually solder to. Okay, let's get some more flux so that it flows nicer. Okay. Now we're going to run a tiny wire. I wasted at least 15 minutes of that person's time. That feels good. I don't feel bad wasting the time of others who waste mine. Remember, I don't care how much flux I add here because this is all going into an ultrasonic anyway. I would never let a board that's this disgusting go back into the hands of a customer. Not exactly the cleanest work here, but yeah. Yeah, that nothing I've done today has kind of been clean. I could make that much shorter. But in trying to make it shorter, I'll probably fuck it up, like I just did. Great. Alright, let's just leave well enough alone, shall we? How about we take our own advice and leave well enough alone? That's shit. All right, let's do this again. Let's grab another solder ball. I can never leave well enough alone. Oh, that was lame as hell. You saw what happened there? One of these balls has got to get stuck there. Okay, that's good. See how it just came went into place? Now, who's going to leave well enough alone once it works? That's good. And guess you know what that is? That's what we like to call good enough. That is what we call good enough. I don't actually know. No, I can't. It's moving. I can literally see it moving. What the? That's such a shit jumper. That's a better jumper than what I should expect given my hands today, but that is still a shit jumper. That's a better jumper. All right. Now we'll have backlight. If this doesn't go on fire, I'll be pretty happy. Come on, turn off. Hecko really should make a pedal for this damn air filter. I hate the switch is so tiny, it's hard to kick. Okay, what do we get? A light or fire? No light and no fire. Boring. Okay. Let's measure backlight voltage again. Lame. I wonder if the feedback ball under the LED driver is good. Tell me we have more here. Let's check the feedback ball under the LED driver. Yeah, it looks fine to me. Okay, now those two pins over here, and you could tell this by using the board view software. This is where backlight output shows up. So that should beep underneath the chip. I can't reach underneath the chip. So let's just see if it beeps to actual backlight on the other side of the board. This is the part that sucks, where you have to measure one side of the board at the same time as the other. I really don't want to solder probes onto the damn board. All right, so we get this. Are you good at going to the bottom of the board? Yes, you are. Okay, so either my jumper sucks, possible that my jumper sucks, or that my LED driver is dead. So let's replace that next. And after that, then this will just start to become a nightmare. That feedback view was definitely broken, though. You saw it with your own eyes. In June? What happened? Oh. Thank you. When the chip is that stubborn about coming off, then That's a decent indicator that it may have been bad. Alright, so now this one on the bottom right is the feedback via, so I just want to make sure that that beeps to where backlight is on this board. So backlight is over here. Again, if you don't know how I know that, and this is the first video of mine you're watching, watch any one of the other hundreds of videos where I show you how I use that board view software. And for the love of God, don't ask me where to get the board view software. I can't tell you. It's not something that's distributed in a legal fashion. I don't have the air as high as I usually do, so I couldn't get the chip to dance. Let's see what the joints look like. Alright, so it did solder itself. Now, I did accidentally touch some areas with the wick, so I gotta have to touch that up. Since I depleted the solder away from some of those resistors, the wick crashed into them. You got some flux there. Definitely needs ultrasonic. Now we wait, because the 2013 air turns on, off, on, off, on, off, and then on. It's its way of building up suspense. Bam. So, a little bit of a nightmare, but hopefully you learned something. So, just to go over it again, since this was a bit of a confusing one to the usual ones, the via that attaches the diode over here to this, see this XW7720? That was blown. My next natural assumption is that it sent a spike to the chip, which destroyed the LED driver, and also or this other crap was ruined. Now, depending on whether I have time, I'll show you what it looks like once it's covered under the green conformal coat and ultrasonically cleaned, all nice and prim and proper for you, but that'll be for later. And as always, thank you for watching, and I hope you learned something. This thing always falls off. Come on. Stick. Hopefully I can get through the queue fast enough to have some time to spend on my amp. Because I really do miss having my music at work. I need my music at work, or I just lose it.